Welcome. I'm Dennis Hartman, the president of the Merrimack Area Chaplaincy Coalition. Welcome to the 69th observance of National Day of Prayer. It is always held on the first Thursday in May. The theme this year is Pray God's Glory Across the Earth. In Habakkuk 2:14, God promises, "For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea." We exist in God's glory and for His glory. We have set our hearts on spreading His glory in prayer. While diligently presenting the gospel and pointing people back to the Word of God in the person of Jesus Christ. 2020 has been declared the year of the Bible, and we are committed to be part of the goal of increasing the Bible engagement across America, as there are no greater words than those that are God-breathed for us to pray, read, and share with a hurting and lost world. God's glory is best shared in His own words and through the prayers and testimony of His people. Thanks to all of you who have tuned in to Facebook or YouTube. We will run this throughout the month of May. Hope you are blessed by joining with us today. At this time, we are going to do the Pledge of Allegiance with Chief of Union Police Department Andy Parker to join us in the pledge, lead us in the pledge. Thank you.
Everyone stand for the pledge, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Andy. At this time, we are going to have some patriotic songs by the Davis family, David and Becky.
Place your hand on His Bible when you swear to tell the truth. His name is on our greatest monuments and all our money too. When we pledge allegiance, there's no doubt where we stand. There's no separation. We're one nation under Him. In God we still trust. Here in America, He's the one we turn to. Every time the going gets rough, He is the source of all our strength, the one who watches over us. Here in America, in God we still trust. He's the one we turn to. Every time the going gets rough, He is the source of all our strength, the one who watches over us. Here in America,
In God we still trust. Here in America. Here in America. Here in America. In God we still trust. Here in America. In God we still trust. Here in America.
And you're keeping inside tears that should have been cried. You've been brave through this trial. You've been as strong as a stone against the stormy winds that have blown. But you have friends who care, more than willing to share. Don't face those troubles alone. Can I pray for you? Can I mention your name to the Lord? When I seek his face, can I plead your case? That's what praying is for.
I'll help you carry your cross and find a way when you're. Just like you've done before, you mentioned me to the Lord.
That's why I'm here to say,
let me be there for you. We'll divide all your problems by two, and very soon there'll be three, you and Jesus and me.
That's what friends are.
Can I pray for you? Can I mention your name to the Lord? When I seek his face, can I plead your case? That's what praying is for.
Can
I plead your case? That's what praying is for.
That's what praying is for. I'll help you carry your cross
and find a way when you're lost.
If we'll let Jesus be true,
I know that he'll see you through.
Can I pray for you? If we'll let Jesus be true,
I know that he'll see you through.
Thank you, Davis family. That was awesome music. At this time, I would like to introduce the chairperson for the Union's National Day of Prayer, Elaine Davis.
That's a hard act to follow. But anyway, you know, when we go back in history, we find that our founding fathers prayed. And not only that, it began to be a pattern in the colonial time. And Franklin Roosevelt said, you know, it shouldn't be just a one-day event. It should be a continuance of prayer. And we're not in America's first crisis by any means. Our nation has faced one danger after another, including medical crises. And during the yellow fever epidemic in Philadelphia in 1793, remember that Philadelphia at that time was the nation's capital and the largest city. And many couldn't flee from the city. The plague lasted for 100 days with at least 5,000 fatalities. Now we have another plague, this COVID-19. And it is now time for us to pray more than ever before. Now for the subsiding of fear, for the ebbing of this pandemic illness, for the upcoming elections, for our leaders, for our world, for unity, and for a sweeping revival to awaken our nation to God. There's no other formula in the Bible that exists for national healing than the ancient words of 2 Chronicles 7:14. Most of us have heard this promise over and over again, but many of us forget that it is conditional. It's conditional on us, the people of God. And when believers meet his condition, then God is going to honor that promise. As we look at our country right now, it is morally bankrupt and in spiritual decline. Vulgarity, indecency, obscenities, lies, threats, sexual immorality, and the breakdown of families are just a few problems that our country faces. And we need healing through God's divine intervention. The solutions to our nation's problem lies not with politicians, reformers, educators, or business leaders, but with God's people. That's us. God's people are those who worship him, who accept and follow Jesus Christ as their Savior, people who are his not just in name, but in every aspect of our lives. In the darkest of situations, the church can call up to God and he will hear. This promise has not expired, people, but remains the key to make it possible for all of his people to take full responsibility for our condition and turn back the spiritual decline. In fact, God has given us four conditions to seeing his healing come to our nation and our lives. And they are centered in the changes that take place in our hearts. Here they are. It begins, if my people who are called by my name, and that's Christian, will first of all humble themselves. Oh, humility means to bow down and be in subjection to. Humility is when we truly understand that how poor and needy we are before God. Simply put, humility means we are utterly dependent on God, which is opposite of pride. You know, in James 4:16, he tells us that God opposes the proud, which is opposite of pride. And so he tells us that. But being humble is a difficult position for most of us because we all tend to depend on any other number of factors than God only. What we need is a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit on our lives. The second item is to pray. This means to ask when you want God to do something for you or for others. God has ordained prayer as a tool to get his work done, and he works in with the praying of his people and his sovereign will. However, we in the church tend to do almost anything but pray, and often treat prayers as though it's the last resort rather than the first thing we should do. All the major revivals have come because of believers who were serious enough to cry out to God in prayer. Number three, seek my face. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. God is personal, and we must deal with him as a real person. When we seek his face, we begin to hear his voice and discover his love and mercy that pardons us from all of our sins. The last one is turn from our wicked ways. The psalmist said, if I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. If we want to experience the presence of God that changes our lives and the world, we need to get rid of anything that pushes Christ from the center of our lives. He hates sin and all forms of wickedness, whether it's abortion, sexual sins, lying, cheating, drunkenness, drug abuse, hatred, jealousy, envy, and fits of rage. And he is not pleased with a church that refuses to stand out against the great evils of our day. When we obey and do these four conditions, then God will hear from heaven. And then he will forgive our sins and heal our land. But be prepared for warfare from Satan. Take control of your thought lives, because the mind is the first place Satan attacks. Praising and confessing the truth of the word will help, plus casting down every thought that is contrary to your prayer. If there are delays to your prayer, let your faith be resolved to trust only God and be more fervent in your prayer. Keep on waiting upon God. In his time and in his power, God will abundantly prove that your faith was not in vain. And if you can't remember anything else, then remember this. Keep your line busy. Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. Those are such powerful words and so true. At this time, praying for the first responders today will be Jim Tayon, the co-founder of Honor Flight here in Franklin County.
Father, we come today to thank you for a very extreme complexity of system of first responders, Father. We thank you that we live in a free country, that we can have such a system. It's not like that everywhere in the world, where our professionals are respected. Father, at the very core, I thank you for the men and women who maintain and the complexity of the electronics for communication, Father, the dispatchers that sit at the phones every second of the day. Father, we wouldn't have the ability to protect life and property if it weren't for these men and women that sit at the phones and allow our cell phones to relay the necessary pleas for help. Father, I beg you to watch over the entire system. I thank you behind the scenes, Father, the Merrimack Chaplaincy Coalition that is praying constantly for our men and women that are on the road, maintaining law and order, protecting property, our fire department, our professionals, the volunteers, Father, the paramedics that are at risk to their own lives, bringing people back to life, our law enforcement that are doing everything from delivering babies in the backseat of police cars to be willing to pull pull people out of burning cars and ditches. Our fire department, Father, that will go into burning homes, pull children out of bed, down the smoky stairs. Father, the helicopter pilots, the people in emergency rooms, we thank you, Father. I pray, Father, that you would watch over these men and women. And I thank you, Father, for watching over us and accepting us just as the way we are. And I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praying for Congress, Supreme Court, and all the federal judges, Bill Spangler, coordinator for the Committee on Prayer, Ridge Church.
Thank you, Brother Dennis. I count it a great pleasure to be here today with our community, and an honor that we can come together and we can seek God's face. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the mighty and strong name of our Lord Jesus Christ. For it's in that mighty name that we have peace and we find direction. Lord, we are asking for divine guidance in our land today. For it was back around 1952 that your servant, Dr. Graham, urged the leaders of our country to proclaim a day of prayer. And because of God-fearing men, a national day of prayer was established. And here we are, over 68 years later, in May of 2020. And there are those that would rather shy away from praying for our country, and some who even occupy offices in our government. And God forbid that this should be. But Lord, in your word, you said, pray for those who have rule over us. And you said, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Even in Israel, God, you chose 12 judges, one from each tribe, to rule and correct those in the land that they were responsible for, the law that you had given. Lord, I pray for our Congress. I pray for our Supreme Justices, that they will serve under direct guidance of your wisdom and your favor. Grant them the knowledge and the obedience as set forth in your word. May they understand the significance of the office in which they reside. I also pray for judges of the appellate courts and the magistrates and district courts, that they will carry out their responsibilities and duties in a godly and honorable fashion. Lord, I pray for the upholding of laws that govern our land that will show glory to God and peace to your people. As our sister said earlier, you said that if we would humble ourselves, seek your face, and turn from our wicked ways, that you would hear our cry. You would forgive our sins, and you would heal our land. God, our land is in need of healing. Lord, we are asking you to send your mighty spirit to our land and bring about a cleansing that will usher your mighty favor and your spirit. No political party or social status will bring about freedom. Only our faith and our trust in you, Father. Your word also said that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And as Patrick Henry said in 1775, give me liberty or give me death. Father God, I choose liberty for your spirit to cleanse. By your word and divine will, God, I pray that you would move into this country. From the east coast to the west coast. From the northern border to the southern shore. Let revival ring out and let us turn ourselves back to you. That you and the people of this land that we choose, they will serve you and bring our country back to you, Lord. I ask your hand upon our great nation, for it's in your mighty, wonderful name, in the name of Jesus, that I pray. Amen.
Praying for the federal and state officials, Pastor John Wagner, First Christian Church of Union.
We have the privilege to pray for those whom we have selected from amongst our own to go into offices to represent us in our state politics as well as our federal. So I want to begin with prayers first off for our state representatives. And in Franklin County, we have four: Aaron Greishamer, John Simmons, Nathan Tate, and Dottie Bailey. They're us. They're who we are made up of, and they take our voices to our state. I also want to lift up our federal representative as well, Blaine Lutkemeyer, as he as well is hearing our voices and taking those before our nation. Our Senator, Dave Schatz, and our U.S. Senator, Roy Blunt and Josh Hawley. They have voices as well that they speak for us. And each and every one of these we have selected from amongst us. It ought to be our duty to continue to lift them up in our prayers on a daily basis. We have others at our state offices as well, such as our Attorney General, Chris Koster, our State Treasurer, Eric Schmidt, and our Auditor, Nicole Galloway. And our Secretary of State, Jay Ashcroft, and Lieutenant Governor Mike Kehoe, and our Governor Mike Parsons. They are all Missourians. They all understand what we're going through because they're going through it as well. But they need our prayers. They need our confidence that they will go before our nation and our state bodies of politics and present what needs to be done in order that we might be able to overcome the struggles that we face. Will you pray with me for these? Father, we know that from amongst us rise men and women who carry our voice with them to our state governing bodies. Father, as they sit within the houses and the Senate, within the Capitol, and Father, they are doing the job that we have sent them there for to do. But Father, may we be that which gird them up and support them as a foundation through our prayers, not just on day as today, but Father, each and every day. Father, we pray that you will give them discernment, that they will know what is right and what is wrong. And Father, in wisdom, they then will make decisions that will be beneficial to the people within our own community. Father, will you allow them to hear the pleas of the people that they represent? And that, Father, with comfort and compassion, that they will deal rightly with us. Father, that you will give them an understanding of what it is at the direction that we need to go to provide for us, protect us, and to promote our benefits. Father, but yet we're facing a struggle that's not only health-wise, but one, Father, that's also reaching into the financial pockets of our people. There are those who are struggling from day to day right now because they have no income. There are those who are sitting back fine because they have been able to store up for themselves just as the ant and the squirrel do. But Father, sometimes those resources, they're not stored up just for us. They're for the benefit of those around us. Father, as our state makes decisions that will be economic in their proportions that will benefit not only the whole body of this great state of ours in Missouri, but Father, they will reach down into the local communities and into the resources that we have here, and Father, they will find ways in which will be a benefit. Keep us honest in our financial dealings. Keep us above board in the decisions that we make in governance, that all these things will be to not only the benefit of our nation, of our state, and Father, of our own communities, but Father, they will be to your glory as well. That the decisions that are being made from the local level on up to the national level, Father, that they will be in accordance with what your will is, not necessarily with what ours is. Sometimes we see with blinders on, and we don't know and we don't understand the full scope of things because our focus is so narrow. But Father, give these whom we have selected to be leaders for us, give them an opportunity to see, unblinded by the things around them, that Father, they would have an understanding and a knowledge that would be best for us at this time. Guide them, guard them, protect them, and Father, lead them so that all things can be done to bring glory not only to your name, but Father, your presence within this world, your church. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Praying for the county and local officials, Associate Pastor Chris Fusco, First Baptist Church in Union.
Glad to be with you guys as we humbly seek our sovereign God, our Creator, together. And as we begin that right now, we will be praying for our Franklin County area and our officials. But I wanted to read a passage of scripture found in Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the promise of your word. God, even in those verses, we're reminded, instead of letting anxiety, fear, worry, and the circumstances of life come crashing down upon us, and Father, they can come in waves, and yet through these times, we can have your peace and knowing that, God, you are sovereign. God, you still rule over all creation, and when it seems like everything is out of control, it's not. God, you continue to rule and to reign and to move history towards your end, Lord. And Father, we just thank you to know, Lord, that we can have full confidence in you. And Father, that whatever comes in our life, you give us the grace and the strength that we need and the wisdom that we need, Father, to glorify you. And Father, we just want to come at this point, Father, and really lift up our Franklin County area, our officials. Lord God, we know that it can be a heavy burden upon them, wanting to lead the people, to do what is best for the people. And Father, we cannot rely upon our own wisdom. Father, our minds are finite. God, we need the infinite wisdom of you, the Creator God. You have given us, Father, your word, the instruction manual for life, the blueprint. And so, Father, instead of relying upon what we always think is best, trying to figure things out on our own, God, we need to seek you. We need your wisdom. We need your help, and we need your strength. We pray for our leaders, Lord God, that they here in Franklin County would humble themselves before you. God, that they would recognize their need, just like Solomon did when he became king over Israel. He realized it was too big of a job for himself. God, he realized his total dependence upon you. And Father, I pray that our officials and our leaders would recognize that as well, Lord God. And Father, you promise to give them the wisdom and the grace and the strength they need as they humble themselves before you and seek you, Lord God. And Father, we know that, Lord, there's a lot of decisions that have to be made. Father, that you would just guide and direct them, Father, to do what is best for the people here in Franklin County area. And Lord, we know there's a lot of people that have a lot of fears and worries, and people that have lost jobs and have all kinds of economic issues. And knowing when to reopen, how quickly to reopen, and so many different matters. And Father, I just pray, Lord God, that you would just help them to humbly seek you, that you would guide them and direct them in what is good, what is safe for our community. And so, Lord, most of all through all this, Father, you created us to be in relationship with you. And Father, in these times, we're reminded that we are temporary. Father, our lives aren't going to last forever. We were created for eternity. God, we were created to be in relationship with you. But as we look at our own hearts, as we look at the world we live in, we see the brokenness. We see the results of sin. Your word says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We see all in all of our hearts, in the world that we live in. Father, we have chosen, just like we saw in the book of Judges, every man did what was right in his own eyes. And Father, we definitely see that even today in our world, in our own hearts, in our country, in the laws that are being passed at times. Father, we ask your forgiveness. But Father, I pray more than anything, we want to pray for our officials here in Franklin County, for the people. We pray, Father, that they would be born again. We pray for their relationship with you. There is nothing more important. That's what we were created for. And though sin has caused us to be separated from you, you and your great love and mercy, when we could do nothing for ourselves, trying to just be religious could not make our sin go away. Just trying to do enough good things cannot make up for our sin. God, you are a holy and just God who must punish sin. So in your great love and mercy, Father, you satisfied your own just demands against our sin through the Lord Jesus Christ, who took on human flesh, God the Son, perfect, who died in our place as our substitute and took the full punishment for sin so that we could be forgiven and reconciled to you if we will simply come up to you, God. Cry out to you, acknowledging our sin. Put our faith and trust not in ourselves, not in our politicians, not in anything except for the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us at the cross, that perfect blood that satisfied your just demands against our sin so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be reconciled to you and be born into your family. God, that is the ultimate purpose for which we were created. And Father, I just pray for that in this Franklin County area, that through this time of anxiety over this COVID-19 and even beyond, Father, that people's hearts and minds would be stirred to seek you, Lord God. And Father, that they would come to put their faith and trust in you as Lord and Savior. And so, Father, we just lift up our community and praying, Father, for not only all those needs and concerns that we just mentioned, but also for their greatest need. Lord, that you would give us the grace and strength you need that we need to boldly live for you, that you would be glorified in everything that we say and do. So, Lord, we lift up, I know, all those first responders, all of our medical folks and that are dealing with this on the front line. God, help them and their families. Protect them, Lord. And, Father, we just thank you to know that we are not going through this alone, but, God, that you've promised your faithful presence with us, Father, every step of the way. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We give you all the glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praying for the unborn and an end to abortion, Amy Caroma, the Crossing Church.
Father, I thank you so much for the power of your word, Lord. And I thank you for your promises, God. And Lord, you say that if we have a need for us to approach your throne of grace with confidence, so that we might receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. God, we say that our nation needs you, God. We are in a time of need, O God, and we desperately need you. And we know that you are attentive to our cry, O God. Father, we've made a mess of things. We've made a mess of things, O God. And the problems that we face are bigger than we can handle. Father, I thank you for the power of the blood of Jesus. Father, I thank you for the promise that the weapons of our warfare They are not carnal, but they are mighty for the pulling down of strongholds. God, there's some giants in our land that we cannot defeat on our own, but we do not shrink back in fear. Instead, we move forward in faith, O God, and we obey you when you say, do not be afraid, but take courage. We want to be like Joshua. We want to be like Caleb. We want to be like Deborah, and we want to move forward, O God. And Lord, we're asking, God, would you remove the stronghold of violence in the womb in our nation and the spirit of death in our nation and violence, O God. So on this day, O God, I'm specifically bringing before you the womb of our nation, O God. God, we're asking you to invade the wombs of our nation, O God. Father, we're asking you to fill the young women who are without hope, to fill them, O God, with hope. God, to fill them with faith that you're enough, that you will take care of them, O God. God, we ask you to forgive us for not taking care of them, for not being there for them, and they are feel like their only option is to destroy the life in their womb. But we want to declare, O God, over Franklin County, that God is enough and that the Church of Jesus Christ will be there for you. And we are so sorry that we have abandoned you. We are so sorry that we haven't been there for you. We're so sorry that we've judged you. Oh God, we ask that the hearts and the homes of Franklin County would open up the doors, oh God, to women in need, would open up their hearts to children that aren't wanted, oh God. God, we ask that you would replace abortion with adoption, oh God. But this is too great for us to accomplish, oh God, because there is demonic laws and decrees in place, oh God, not only in Franklin County, Lord, but in our nation, oh God. And we're asking you, like you overturned the tables in the temple, oh God, would you overturn demonic laws and decrees, oh God, because we can't do this on our own. God, we ask that you would burn up every demonic altar in the name of Jesus and command it to crumble, oh God. Just like the God of Moloch in the Old Testament, when the Israelites, they sacrificed their children to the God of Moloch, oh God. This false God is too great for us, oh God. But it's not too great for the power of the blood of Jesus. So we say we trust, we rely, and we depend upon you, oh God, to overturn these demonic laws. Lord, there have been 53 million children murdered in the wombs of our women. 53 million, God. Where is the outcry, oh God? Well, today, oh God, there is an outcry, and we're asking you to intervene, oh God. We ask you to forgive us, oh God, in any part that we played. Forgive us, oh God. And Father, we ask that the healing balm of Gilead would cover the women that felt they had no choice but to destroy the life in their womb, oh God. Father, we ask that you would reverse this in the name of Jesus, Lord. Psalm 74:20, for the dark places of the land are full of the habitations of violence. Lord, the dark places of the womb are full of violence. Father, we ask that you would reverse that. Let not the oppressed return dishonored. Let the afflicted and the needy praise thy name. Father, we ask that you would heal our nation, O God. We ask that you would return, O God, that you would reverse, O God, these decrees, O God, and these laws. Father, I just ask that you would raise up godly men and godly women that would have courage, O God. That they would have courage, O God. We ask that you would raise up godly judges, O God, like you raised up Eliakim to replace Shebna. God, you uprooted Shebna, and you replaced him with Eliakim, who was a godly man, who feared you and who cared about the people. I thank you, O God, that you're going to depose the wicked, O God. You're going to oust them from their position because you hear the outcry and you hear our prayers, O God. Father, we ask that you would uproot ungodly judges, that you would cause their hearts to turn to you. And if they don't turn to you, O God, we're asking today before your throne, we're asking you to uproot ungodly judges and replace them with godly men, that you would uproot ungodly legislators, ungodly people in our government, and that you would replace them with people like Eliakim, a man who will be faithful to me, who will be trustworthy, and to whom the interest of the city, the interest of the womb, the interest of these women may be safely confided, a man or a woman who will not seek to betray it into the hands of the enemy. God, would you do this for us? Because it is just like David, he stood before that giant and he was too great for him, Lord. But you gave him the power, O God, to overcome. I thank you, O Father. Thank you, Father. And I thank you, Lord, that you are our judge according to Isaiah 33:22. You are our lawgiver. The Lord is our king, and it is you who will save us, O God. I thank you, O God, for hearing our cry. We thank you, O God, for what you're going to do, O God. You're going to overturn abortion because you have heard our prayers, O God. You are going to overturn abortion, O God, and you are going to replace death with life, O God. So we just speak life into the womb of America. We speak hope, and Father, we say as the body of Christ, we open up the doors of our hearts and the doors of our homes, O God, to the unwanted children, Lord. And we ask that you would empower us to do that, O God, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Praying for the military and the war on terror. Tom Hines, who served our country as a Marine with the Ridge Church.
I have nothing written down. I'm really not used to praying in public like this. It was mainly quiet in my little room or. And after hearing Amy talk here, it opens up your eyes to death. Did you know that hearing her, there are more babies killed than men and women killed in wars? That's pretty sad. When I was fortunate, started my eight-year obligation in 1954, so Korea had ended, and I was out before Vietnam started. So I feel a little, for years I didn't think I was a veteran because it was a Cold War. But other veterans have told me, when you sign your name on that dotted line, you're entering a contract that even your life is part of it. So when I come before you in prayer this morning, that's what I want you to remember, that these young men, 1% of our population, are your sons and your daughters. I pray for them now. Most gracious Heavenly Father, I come before your throne of mercy and grace in humble adoration and thankfulness, thanksgiving. Father, we have men and women in harm's way. And Father, it's a different world now. They don't know who their enemy is. There's no uniform. They'll walk behind children as shields. And what it does to these young men and women when they come back, they still see those visions, Lord. They still see those deaths. And in some, it takes their own lives in suicide. Please, Lord, place a veil of protection over our young men and women who are in harm's way and those who have served in harm's way. Father, let them know that you're there for them and they don't have to cry anymore. Let them know that you're blessing them for doing what the scriptures say, that we should obey our rulers or presidents. When we sign that, we say that we're going to uphold the Constitution of the United States. It's a blessed oath to us, and it is a brotherhood, Lord. And I ask everyone here today, Lord, when they see a Vietnam veteran with the hat that says Vietnam, go up to him and say, "Welcome home, brother. Welcome home." Lord God, I pray this in Jesus' most holy and precious name. Amen.
Praying for the broken families and sacredness of marriage, Pastor Vic Brown, the True Vine Fellowship.
Just an addendum, I was not thanked until 20 years after returning from Vietnam for the first time. And I can't explain to you what it did to me emotionally. When a brother reached out and shook my hand and said thank you. So thank you so much for mentioning that. Elaine, who has always been an example to us for so many years as just a prayer warrior and someone who doesn't just begin a prayer but continues to pray, and her heart is poured out and her life matches the requirements for God hearing our prayer. And it's one of the things that the Lord, I was thinking of 2 Chronicles as well. And the big word that sticks out there is if. If my people, me and you, those of you who are going to be tuning into this, what I'm going to be praying about, you're actually going to put faces and names to the prayer. We all know of people who are going to fall in these categories of broken homes. Kids that have been affected, men and women who have been affected, and the sanctity of marriage and how our marriages have not held up as Christian marriages. And because there's a lack of humility as a requirement of 2 Chronicles 7:14 in our hearts, we have taken positions and sides, and we're still married maybe, but it isn't what is honoring to the Lord. And out of that has come a lack of impact in our culture, in our friends, in our neighbors, because of our own positions of lack of humility, lack of facing our own standoff positions, our own sins, and then seeking the Lord, understanding that we can't do this by ourselves. But here's a wonderful gift from God. And out of that comes children and relationships and grandchildren, And a great impact, a heritage for our country that the Lord has called us to as Christians. And so as we seek him and pray for these, we just, I would ask that, you know, humility is something we've talked about here. And I don't think any of us can claim that we're at the bottom, that we're the most humble people in the room. And as I pray, one of the conditions is that you who are listening, all of us, as we join in prayer, seek the Lord and humble ourselves. I can't humble for you. You can't humble for me. But that's what it's going to take. And if out of that humility comes a sensitivity to something in our lives that we need to seek the Lord for, then he says, I will hear that prayer. I may be more eloquent than you in praying, but with the prayer that he's going to hear out of all these prayers and out of your prayers is people who know him, who need him, see our own brokenness and the brokenness around us, and we're going to seek him. So let's pray together. And would you put just names and faces as we pray to what I'm going to say in your behalf. And as you join in, as the Holy Spirit just causes you to say yes, 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 yes. Father, we come before you because we need you. And Father, we don't have the answers, but you do. And you have pledged yourself to direct us, to encourage us, to help us. You've given us truths to live by. And Father, as we honor you in your word, you do honor us and you bless us. And so, Father, we do pray for families and marriages that have compromised. And we ask, Father, that you would bring into those marriages a wonderful new renewal. We ask, Father, that there'd be a humbling before one another. There would be examples set in those families for these children, for the brokenness that's already out there. And Father, for how you have, in your mercy, watched over children. We, each of us know those children. We pray for them. We pray, Father, for all the ways in which we try to talk to those children when they don't have any support at home. Through our Sunday schools or Good News Clubs or whatever organization or whatever ministry. Father, we pray that you give courage and strength and sensitivity and love as you want to express yourself to these children. And they are very much on your heart. We pray for men and women who have made pledges of marriage, and yet, Father, they need help. We all need help. We pray for those who are living together and they haven't found it necessary to make a commitment to one another and really say, I love you so much that I'm willing to commit to you. I'll marry you. If we're going to live together, I wanted to show you how much I love you. I want us to get married. I just thank you, Father, for what you have in mind for our country and the beauty of what you've given to us. May you forgive us for compromises that we've made, that we've adopted some of the standards of those around us in our country, our culture. I pray that you drive us back into your word. And Father, that we might just spend time with you in your word, and ministering to us by your Holy Spirit and causing us to pray for those who need special help. And may we be that light, may we be that humility that they will see and can identify with only because of who you are and what you've done in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praying for the church, pastors and revival, Pastor Gary Dowd, Hospice Chaplain, Mercy Hospice.
I too had kind of prepared my prayer based on passage in 2 Chronicles. But I'd like to share with you also a passage from Psalms 51 before prayer. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take the Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners will turn back to you. Let's pray for our pastors, our churches, and revival. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of coming together this day. And Lord, we just say yes and amen to everything that's already been prayed. And Lord, it's now, Lord, we take these moments to pray for our churches. We cannot believe what we're going through, and nobody could have ever predicted this. But Lord, this did not happen as a surprise to you. And we believe, dear God, that as our individual churches, Lord, make plans and preparations over the next days or weeks to begin to open up their sanctuaries again in whatever form it takes, that you would give them wisdom, that you would give them grace, that you would, dear God, protect those who choose to come out. Lord, these are difficult times. And Lord, we need your wisdom. And our pastors and our churches, dear God, are facing things that they have never faced before. In fact, we've never faced anything like this before. But God, you said those who ask for wisdom, you will grant it. And so we pray for wisdom, dear Father, for our pastors and for the churches and their leadership boards, deacons, that you would, dear God, just guide them. But not just in the ways opening their doors again, but God, to be able to minister to the needs of their congregations, to be able to understand the financial, but the spiritual needs that are represented in those people. And we know, dear God, that you are on the throne. And God, we need you. And our pastors need you. And our churches need you. And Lord, what we prayed, dear God, for Lord wisdom, we also prayed for revival. As we've shared this passage from Psalm 51, it's a psalm of David, a time of confession after a deep, deep sin. But I love how you reminded him and to pray that, Lord, create a steadfast spirit. Lord, we need a steadfast spirit. We need, Heavenly Father, to have the joy of our salvation renewed within us again. We need, Heavenly Father, for you to just to bring peace back into our lives. But Lord, we're so thankful, dear God, for Lord's prayer for a willing spirit, because we want to be led by you. But then the promise is still here. If we do all these things, if we confess, if we ask you to restore and not take the Holy Spirit from us, then you will teach transgressors their ways. And we do ask for a great revival among our communities. We know, Heavenly Father, that in the churches, as they come back together, there's going to be a lot of uncertainty and a lot of different kind of emotions. But we pray, dear God, for a spirit of revival to sweep across us. We know, dear God, that people need you. We know, Heavenly Father, that people are scared. And we also recognize this opportunity that we have as churches and as leaders in the community to help guide them into a right relationship to you, that no matter what happens, no matter what challenges that we face, no matter what uncertainties of the days ahead are, that they could be in right relationship to you. So grant us wisdom. Grant us peace. Grant us, Heavenly Father, your Holy Spirit to guide us and lead us. Because we pray in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Praying for the influences of media, Hollywood, and technology on our youth, Sean Ratcliffe, youth pastor at the First Christian Church in Union.
We live in a unique period of time. The flow of information directed at all of us, 24/7, it is overwhelming. And as I was contemplating what the focus of this prayer would be, I came back to John 17:17. Sanctify them in your truth. Your word is the truth. We are flooded with so much information. Our students are constantly coming to that same place that Pilate was. What is truth? What is truth? Is truth relative? Is truth absolute? Truth is right here. And as we pray really against the massive amount of information that is flooding our students through the media every single day, into our homes, into our hands with our cell phones, just nonstop. Let's find ourselves rooted in this book right here. Heavenly Father, we have let the enemy in. 70 years ago, we had one TV and a newspaper. Right now, We have more windows into our home and into the hearts of our children than we could scarcely count. There is just so much coming constantly through music and movies, through the internet, through our cell phones, through magazines, everything telling our children what they should be and how they should look and what they should believe and what their future should look like and what their values should be. It is overwhelming. It is a miraculous thing every single day that one of our young people would choose to put their heart and their trust in you. It truly is, because the world is so inundated, so persuasive, and so prevalent in every single aspect of our lives. Lord, I pray for our students. Lord, I pray that you would guard their hearts, that they would find themselves rooted in your truth, grounded in your word, that you would create in them a fire, a passion, an absolute, just all-consuming zeal for your word. Lord, I pray that you would guard their hearts, that you would raise parents up, that you would have parents alert and observant. It's so easy, so incredibly easy in the hustle and bustle and the flow of life. I'm guilty of it myself, to get distracted, to lose track of what's going on with our kids. Lord, help us, raise us up as parents to be alert, to be proactive, not reactive, but to be pouring into our children. Lord, we pray that you would raise up a new, and I've seen great, tremendous growth in just the last 5 years, but that you would continue to raise up people in the media to step forward, to put out Christian programming, to put out, you know, movies and music and to adapt, you know, to take this gospel, to take this truth and present it in a way that has a meaningful impact to our young people in the face of all this. Lord, I just pray for each and every student, Lord, that is transitioning at this period of time, right now, during this coronavirus period of time, between high school and college. There is already such a tremendous gap that is created in that transition from adolescence to adulthood, Lord. It's already a struggle to keep people connected. And how much more so losing milestones like graduation and that smooth transition into that. So I just pray that you would raise up leaders, Christian leaders, to step in and pour into these students' life, that would walk in ignited for these students, just pouring out your love and light and your energy, and that their students would just receive that, and you would gather them to you as that mother hen gathers the chicks under her wings, Lord. We just pray for you to have a tremendous movement, that you would take these students that are going through this period of time and just ignite them. They would have a passion for you and to share you with others, Lord, and that this would serve as a turning point, a sea change, that we would see more students flocking back to the church, Lord, more college students flocking back, that we would see more families firing back, Lord, and trying to get rooted and grounded in you and in your word. Lord, that you would just put a buffer, a shield, that you would help us to just be alert to that constant war that is not against the flesh, it is against spiritual principalities and the wicked, you know, wickedness in the heavenly realm, Lord, that you would strike them dead, that you would help us with that sword of the Spirit, with your truth, to stand firm on this evil day and every evil day that is to follow until you call us home, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praying for the education system, homeschooling, parochial schools, public community colleges, and universities, Dr. Kurt Keller, 17 years as a principal in the public schools.
Thank you, Dennis. Isn't it so very good to be in the house of God? And this has been just an awesome experience to be part of these prayers. You know, normally, the first Thursday of May, you would see middle school and high school students gathered around the flagpole in front of their school praying for our nation and for their schools, and we're not having this. So one of my prayers is that this really touches many, many people to know that our God is alive and real and that it is going to get us through all this situation. The first group that I want to pray for when we talk about education is I want to talk about our students. Our students are the ones that have been greatly impacted. And that's what education is about. It's about the students. I want to also pray that we pray for our public school teachers. We want to pray for those teachers who are working with the preschoolers, that those preschool teachers would have love and compassion and be nurturing, because that's, they're in many cases taking the place of the parents because the parents have to work. We want to pray for those kindergarten teachers, those teachers that are really for the first time introducing the kids to learning. You know, I've worked with my grandchildren with their sight words and their basic math facts where they start in kindergarten, and just what a responsibility those kindergarten teachers have. We want to pray for our elementary teachers, those teachers that are really the ones that are instilling the love of learning in our children. That should be and hopefully will be a lifelong endeavor to always try to learn. We want to pray for our middle school teachers, those teachers that are working with our youth who are going from adolescence to adulthood and all the new hormones they're experiencing and all the trials they're having with being a young adult. We want to pray for our high school teachers, those teachers who have the responsibility of being the last to deal with our kids and preparing them for the work world or for college and just adult life. We want to pray for the Christian school teachers who have just a responsibility, added responsibility of also making sure that the kids know that Jesus is their best friend. During this time of COVID-19, we also want to pray a special prayer for those parents who are now trying to educate their kids at home and to follow those lesson plans that they're getting off the internet or in packets that are been sent home. We want to pray for those homeschool teachers that have been educating their children for years and years. We want to pray for the school administrators, the assistant principals, the principals, the superintendents, that they would be making good decisions that would positively impact education. We want to pray for the local school boards, those people that dedicate their time freely so that they can help our children become what all they should be. We want to pray for the state education officials, those people working at MoDESI, headed by Dr. Margie Vandiver, that they would do the right thing and support our schools, both financially and with the equipment and needs that all the schools need. We want to pray for the professors and colleges, in the colleges and universities, that they would teach the kids their subject and not try to instill their values in our students. We want to pray for the local FCA huddles and the FCA huddle leaders, those teachers and student leaders who are trying to bring Christ into the public schools. We want to make sure that all kids come out being very good readers and very good in math, because those are the two key subjects to students being successful lifelong. We want to also pray for a school that our church has worked with down in El Salvador, a Christian school. We want to pray that they will continue to have a positive impact on their city and on their country. And we also want to pray with the schools in Senegal, West Africa, that they would also positively impact their schools. We just want to take a moment and just really be mindful of all those people who are having to deal with the disruptions caused by COVID-19. And we've got the bus drivers and the cooks, and those people who many financially need those jobs, and those of the secretaries. Those have been disruptive, and many of those people are just trying to get by financially, so we want to be also mindful of them. Also at this time, many of our college students are beginning to take finals. We want to be mindful of those college students as they're taking finals in a brand new way, many of them online, and this hope, our hope and prayer are that they will get through those successfully. And then lastly, we want to remember those high school seniors who have lost their senior year. They've lost that senior prom. Many of them will lose that thrill of walking across the stage and having friends and family cheer for them as they get their high school diploma. We just pray that there will be decisions made so that those kids will some way have some experience to remember. We can pray. Our Lord and most high Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for how you are with us and how you walk with us. And we just ask you to be with the educational system and all those kids. And we just pray that you'll instill a desire to learn and that all of our kids will become the very best that they can be. But most importantly, Lord, that they will find you as their Lord and Savior and know that no matter what the world throws at them, whether it be another pandemic, that you will walk by them and that you will guide them and you will support them because you're our best friend, Jesus. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praying for the business community, the workplace, as well as workers that are out of a job at this time, Joe Lasky with Husky Corporation.
Father, as we turn our thoughts and prayers towards the business community, I'm reminded of your words in the book of James, chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and unabradeth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. Lord, our brothers and sisters in the business community need your wisdom today more than ever. The absence of income for the last several months and the coming days where rules and conditions for slow reopenings are being placed on them have and will be challenging. For those business owners and those in management roles, I pray for wisdom, not just earthly wisdom, but wisdom that comes from above. I pray that they would not lean unto their own understanding in the days to come, but that in every way they would acknowledge you and that you would direct their paths. Give them grace and wisdom to navigate the challenges that are and will continue to come their way. Let them see your hand in some small way each day, that their confidence in you may increase, and then that their testimonies of your grace and faithfulness will begin to overflow. Help them to walk through these challenges and be alongside them to be their provider and strength and comforter and friend. Let the choices that they make be prayerfully considered. Let the decisions that they have to make be clear. Let them see evidence that you are going before them and leading them through each and every situation they face. When they are unsure, be their confidence. When they grow weary, be their strength. Let their faith in you grow each day as you show yourself large on their behalf. For the employees, Lord, who have not been working for the last few months and are dealing with challenges and stress from not having regular income, I pray that they would not lose hope. I pray that they would draw close to you. I pray that they would keep their confidence in you. I pray that they would have the faith of David as he faced Goliath, and that they would trust you and your faithfulness and your provision to be larger than the temporary financial challenges that this pandemic has created. Pray that you would provide them a peace that passes all understanding, that you would walk beside them also and show yourself as their provider and strength and comforter and friend. Father, I also want to pray for those in our community who face these same challenges but don't know you as Lord and Savior. I lift them up as well. I ask that through these challenging times that they would not lose hope, but that these times would turn their gaze towards you. that in this time of tribulation they would come to know you, the one true God, that you would wrap your arms around them and comfort them, and that they might receive and trust Jesus as Lord and Savior. Father, take what the enemy meant for evil and turn it into good by running to those who look to you and add souls to your kingdom. I pray that they turn to you and that you would walk them through these coming days with confidence and faith. Father, for those of us who have come through this pandemic with little more than a bit of inconvenience, help us to hear your voice and how we can minister to those around us who have suffered during this time. Open our eyes to the needs around us, speak to our hearts, and direct us on how we can be the hands and feet of Jesus during this time. We want to bless you as we bless others. And lastly, Father, I pray that Psalm 18:2 would become our life banner. Pray that you would remind us all that the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength in whom I will trust, my shield and the horn of my salvation and my stronghold. Thank you for your loving kindness, Lord, now and in the days to come. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
In praying for our president, the vice president, and the administration, Jim Plymouth, Franklin County Baptist Association.
Thank you. Being a preacher is awfully hard to not start off preaching after all of these scriptures, reading and praying. But because of time, we don't have time. We're running a little late, I think. So let me just focus our prayer as it's the last prayer. I don't necessarily say it's the most important prayer, but I guess of all, it affects us more than any other area that we are talking about today, and that is the prayer for our President of the United States and for his Vice President, for his administration, as indeed what he says and what he does and his administration does certainly affects each and every one of us, where the other ones locally are very important, but don't always affect our whole country the same way, of course. So today we want to pray for President Donald Trump, for Vice President Michael Pence, for his Chief of Staff Mark Meadows, for all of his cabinet members, and I'm not going to take the time to list them by name, but I'd encourage you to do that as you can and when you can, and for his ambassadors that are scattered all around the world representing President Trump in our United States, doing a very important ministry and work. So, but anyway, let's join together in prayer. Father, what a privilege it is to come and lift to you our president of our great and wonderful country that you have blessed us to be a part of. Father, we don't take it lightly that we have the privilege to be a part of this great country. We have been blessed beyond measure and beyond description to live in the United States of America in this time. Father, we thank you for the president, for his position, as it is admonished to us in scriptures to pray for our leaders, pray for our kings, pray for our president and our leaders over us. We thank you for his stands, Father, for religious liberty. And Lord, for the core values of our faith and for the life principles that we find in the Holy Scriptures. And Lord, even though most of us, many of us, or not all of us perhaps, would maybe disagree with some areas of his life and his deportment and his conduct and character, Lord, there are so many things that we so thank you for as he upholds and supports these core values of our faith in Scripture. Lord, we thank you for his leadership of our country and his many and tireless efforts to strengthen our country's military, to strengthen us politically, to strengthen us economically, to strengthen us spiritually, even though he is our not a spiritual leader per se, but certainly he is aware and concerned about that and has an impact on that as our leader of our country. Thank you for his confession of his faith in Christ as his Savior and his dependence and desire to have him lead him in his decision making and in his service as president, and for his acknowledgement of his desire to have us pray for him as Christians around the world, here in our country especially. So, Father, we pray for him as particularly not only all the other many things he does as president, but, Lord, now particularly all the challenges that we have upon us thrusted by this COVID-19 ravage. And, Lord, it says all have known and said it's something like none have ever seen, and we've never had to deal with as a country in this way. And so, God, we need your continued guidance and wisdom for our president and his administration as they help us through these times. Father, we do lift up our president. We pray for his health. We pray for his health physically, in his body. We pray for him mentally, in his mind, and his thinking. And Lord, certainly we pray for him spiritually, for him to have a vital walk with you and a sense of your presence. And Lord, that you would have a vital relationship with him and not just be a person or someone on a paper that he reads or talks about or thinks about from time to time. Father, we pray for the attacks of Satan against him. And Lord, Satan certainly knows the importance of bringing down our leaders and to try to undermine the work and the role of our national leaders to help guide and protect our country. So I pray against Satan and all of his host of demons as they would tend to try to attract and try to undermine the work of the president, to attack him even physically. So protect him. Father, we pray for the wisdom for President Trump and for continuing guidance and your wonderful, matchless blessing on his life and his service, that you would do that in such a way that our country would be blessed and continue to be blessed as a country, one nation under God. And Father, we pray you do this in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and for his eternal glory. In his name I pray. Amen.
Please join us in the closing song, God Bless America.
Those here, let's stand together. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her with the from the light from above, from the mountains to the prairies, from the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home.
I want to thank you all for watching on YouTube and on Facebook. We will play this every day throughout the entire month of May. Also want to thank our prayer warrior, Elaine Davis, who made this possible. And the work she did on this. Thank you to the Ridge Church for hosting and all the churches that came together and all the people that came together to make this possible and participated in this today. God bless you all. Amen.